We're going to look at Hebrews 13, 17 through 25. And we're going to read the verses out loud, the public reading of Scripture. This is from the English Standard Version of the Bible, but we have it on the screen for you. Let's try to do this in unison. Obey your leaders and submit to them, for they are keeping watch over your souls, as those who will have to give an account. Let them do this with joy and not with groaning, for that would be of no advantage to you.
Pray for us. We are sure.
Honorably in all things, I urge you more earnestly to do this in order that I may be restored to you. I left those out of my notes. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Final greetings. I appeal to you, brothers, bear with the word of exhortation, for I have written to you briefly. You should know that our brother Timothy has been released, with whom I shall see you if he comes soon. Greet all your leaders and all the saints. Those who come from Italy send you greetings. Grace be to all. Amen. You know, we're committed to teaching every word of the Word of God. I always tell people I'm not going to bore you with every word of the Word of God. Now, when I say that, people say, you're saying the Word of God is boring. No, that's not what I said. I said, I am trying not to be boring. The Bible is a very interesting book. Here's our message map for today. We're going to look at these scriptures, how the Lord, leaders are those who keep watch over your souls. In God's eyes. We're not talking about secular leadership here. We're talking about the people that God has anointed to lead his people, his church. God holds all accountable. He especially holds leaders accountable to cooperate with him. The leadership challenge is to act from a pure conscience. Christ's work on the cross equips us to bear up under the exhortation so that we can be accountable to God. If you're new to this, they're going to be, next slide, you'll see some blue words. The blue words are your fill-ins in your note page. So, leaders are spiritual watchkeepers. Leaders are those who go before. I unpack these words in the Greek, as a chief, to properly keep watch. Now, that's an interesting term in the Greek. It means over your souls, but it means that they carefully stay vigilant, they're alert and attentive, being faithful, without taking any unnecessary time off. We as leaders who take our call seriously before God are on duty every day, every week. We do know when to rest, right? Wise people know when to take a break. And we are mindful of the needs of people, the desires and the hurts and the longings that are going on throughout the body of Christ. I was in Alabama this week and had a discussion with someone about why are you running all over the place doing the things you're doing. I said, I'd go to Alaska. Heck, I've already been to Malaysia a few times. I'd go to Dubai. The word of God can only work where it's heard. Faith comes by hearing. And so when I'm talking to people, I try to quote scripture as much as possible because it's not about me, it's about him. I can't bring joy to anybody, but Jesus can. So we're looking for the Lord to use us sometimes in unusual places. Somebody accused me yesterday at the Revelation conference, you just want us to run to the mountains and hide. I said, no, I want you to run to the mountains and prepare and then come back here and live. It's both and and, it's not either or. 1.1 million Christians were preserved in the first century by doing exactly what Jesus said. When the armies started marching towards Jerusalem, they went to the mountains, just like Jesus said. Both and and. All right, next slide. You know, if I was a secular leader and I used secular reasoning, I'm kind of dragging us out of God's purview for our lives. Anyway, leaders have to give an account. What does it mean to give an account? It means you answer by reporting to God. Leaders, not only leaders, but everybody who serves, we're supposed to do it with joy. The joy of the Lord is our strength. You know, before I came to Christ, I used to try to look really tough, and I would always squint at people and, you know, trying to keep the pain away. And then I came to Christ, and I started smiling more. I became a happier person. The world is still bad. I still had the same job and everything else. But Christ gave me joy in everything that I do. I began to do things as unto the Lord. Do you know that the Industrial Revolution was started by people who believe that everything we do as unto the glory of the Lord? And so whether you were, the Puritans brought this to America, whether you were a carpenter or a lumberjack, or whether you were shoeing horses, or you were a plumber or a metalsmith, people began to look to God to say, Lord, how can I do what you're calling me to do better? And it sparked the Industrial Revolution. The parable of the talents. Take your talents and multiply them for the glory. Do some God-honoring things that people are willing to pay you a profitable price to enjoy. And there's a win-win there. They get the stuff, you get the money. And if more people buy your stuff, you've got to use the money to hire more people. In America, we traditionally have competed for employees by offering health benefits and vacation benefits. And I listen to our government say, oh, all these business people are bad. Well, that's not how our country was founded. That's not what the Puritans did. As a matter of fact, you can go around the world and you could track the most inventive societies by the way they allowed Christianity to inspire them to do God-honoring things in the world, common everyday things. There are countries in South America where another religion controls those countries. And there have been no innovations in those countries. Even though that religion calls itself Christian, it's not. It's only Christianity that provides amazing benefits for our world. One of our challenges today is that our children are not going to college to learn about the joy of the Lord. They go to college and all they hear is groaning. Oh, the environment's bad, which is a lie against the creative goodness of God. A guy told me that his pastor bought a church, and he got a vision to buy a church by a lake. They found the address, but there was no lake. 2 years later, the rock quarry across the road hit water, and now it's a lake. People tell me, well, we're going to run out of water. I'm like, are you aware that 3/4 of the earth's surface is water? If you think nature needs man's help, just go look at an abandoned building and look at the trees growing through the roof. So, as we're serving God, we're not supposed to do it with groaning. That means you're expressing grief, anger, moaning, with a desire to do something else. For that would be of no advantage. It means it's going to be unprofitable. It's actually, that word means ruinous and detrimental to you, to the church. And we all have to learn to do what we're doing with joy. Because I think it's a human tendency. The lowest form of knowledge is to know enough to complain. And I learned a long time ago that never bring your boss a problem that you don't have a solution for. Otherwise, you're just bringing your boss complaints. So God is saying, as in 2 Timothy 2:24 through 26, which I'm going to read, and the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil. You ever have people walk up to you? And I was standing in a line this past week. I was in Alabama, and there was a guy in front of me in a gray sweatsuit. And tattoos, bald head, big guy. I said, hey, what are you doing? Where are you going? He goes, well, I just got out of prison and I'm on my way to Texas. I said, what are you doing in Texas? He goes, I'm going to a halfway house. I said, why'd you go to prison? He goes, well, I'm a counterfeiter. He goes, I pretended I had a business and I would take stacks of $100 bills to the bank And I would say, well, my cashiers need changes. So I would change those $100 in, $100 bills in for 50s and 20s and 5s. And I said, well, how much did you make off of it? He goes, $490,000. I said, look at you. You're an enterprising young man. Can't you find, I mean, you're a talented guy. Can't you put that to good use and do something that's God-honoring that'll bring good things to life for other people for which they're willing to pay you for? And he goes, well, the economy was bad.
Not for you, that bad.
So anyway, I told him I'm going to start praying for him. So if you don't do things in the right way, it becomes unprofitable. You get caught once, and it takes $500,000 of crime and throws it out the window. We got to learn to do things God's way. We got to give people a vision of what God wants to do with their lives. So God is saying we have to patiently endure evil. I could have freaked out on that young man and said, what on earth are you doing? Are you stupid? No. The Bible says in verse 25, correcting his opponents with gentleness. God may perhaps grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth. You know, when we talk to people, do we have an expectation that they can actually repent? Or do we say, we put them in a box? Oh, that's a bad person. You're bad. I got to say, we don't smoke, we don't drink, we don't chew, and we don't go with girls or boys that do. No, we have to understand, we have to leave room for God to work in people's lives. We have an expectation that God can work in people's lives. And sometimes it's challenging because we do face rejection. We see people take a step towards the Lord and then they take a step back away from God and they give you excuses why they are not going to follow God. I was walking away from a person this week and someone said, boy, that was kind of an interesting conversation. I said, that's where they are today. We should add a yet to everything that person said. I'm not doing this yet. Look at us. How many of us argued with Christians before we came to Christ? How many of us thought we would pontificate about man and God and law, and we didn't know who God is, we didn't understand the Bible, we thought we knew everything, but the Lord moved us. He humbled us. He spoke to our hearts. That's the expectation I have that God is going to do in other people's lives. So that they could be led to a knowledge of the truth, and they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil after being captured by him to do his will, as many of us were. So yesterday at this Revelation conference, I had to balance patient teaching with gentle correction. I was expecting to go there to learn something too. Next slide. Now, what's this accountability thing about? I've known a lot of people who have said to me, I'm going to go to my church and I'm going to ask them to pray with me and to help me make a particular decision. And then they call me up and say, well, the church told me this, but I'm going to go do that. And I tell those people, I've never seen it work well, where you go and seek godly counsel, and somebody actually says they're going to fast and pray for you, and then you have a couple meetings with them, and then you go in an opposite direction. I have never seen that work well. God has three answers to every prayer: yes, no, and wait. And if you think, I know the person you're talking about, what you're saying about that person is 100% true from my perspective, but you've put this in the hands of God to work through that person, I would kind of go on autopilot here and trust what the Lord is doing. Because the worst thing that's happened is wait. They're saying no for now, but that could be a wait. Let's prove this thing out. But time and time again, you see people jump, and it goes very poorly. I've seen it happen many, many times, especially in marriage counseling. Because during marriage counseling, things get revealed about people that you didn't know before. All we gotta do is wait. We got married in a fever, hotter than a pepper sprouse. We've been talking about Jackson. Ever since the fire. All right. Okay, all right, we're going to go there. All right, now, what does it mean to obey? It means to be persuaded by the Lord to have confidence in Him as a believer. I believe in God. I want the Holy Spirit to work in me to persuade me to yield to God's will. It says, because these people are keeping watch over your souls, that means that's your psyche, that's the seat of your affections and your will. It's the essence of your character, the seat of your personality. We want Christ to transform our personality. I was at a conference once years ago. I was a Christian, and a guy walked up to me and he says, "Why are you so angry?" And that convicted me. I had won the largest retroactive settlement via history for a veteran. I had discovered some things about our government, and it was making me angry. And I realized this is not the way to go about this. So I began to literally pray, "Lord, I need you to change my personality. I need you to make me the kind of person who could hang out with those people and not be angry." And he did. Did I compromise who I was in Christ? Nope. The Bible says we are in the world, but we are not of the world. So we want to do some very God-honoring things in the world, looking to the Lord to use our talents, our gifts, and our abilities the way He's wired us so we can do some God-honoring things in the world, but we're doing it Christ way. So, submission is to our advantage because it benefits us to cooperate with God's plan for our lives. The Lord asks us to do something instead of saying, "I can't because." An older pastor told me this in Alabama. He said, when people say "but," they're saying, it doesn't matter what the Word of God says, it doesn't matter all that's come before, I have a challenge with that. I don't want to do it. Or I think I can't do it because. He goes, the word "but," I told him there are times when we have, in our messages, we have a little expression, we're going to start kicking butts. So submission is to your advantage, our advantage, because it helps us to cooperate with God. So we say, "Lord, if you're calling me to this," okay, I can look in the mirror and I can say, "God, you know what I'm like? How can you do this through me? Or with me? I want to do it, but I don't see how you can do it, given who I am, what I don't have, what I don't know, who I don't know, what I am and what I'm not." Just say, "Lord, if you want to use me, you work out all those details." So I've known, now, this is a bit different than my will for God. If I humble myself before the Lord and say, "Yes, Lord, I sense that you may be calling me to this. I don't feel worthy, but I know you're calling me." So the question is not yes or no now. It's about how. I'm looking for you, Lord, to work out the how. Next slide. The leadership challenge is to have a pure conscience before God. We're working towards accountability with God. Well, we have to have a pure conscience to do that. A clear conscience only comes from prayer, which transfers Christ's character to us. The word "clear" means honorable. That which embraces what is beautiful and praiseworthy. We want to see people as Christ sees people. That doesn't mean we're going to be doormats or suckers. But we want to see people as God sees people. I don't want to put you in your sin box. I got my own sin box. We want to believe the best for each other that we can get beyond this. A clear conscience, you know what conscience is? It's a God-given capacity of moral and spiritual perception that comes from us being created in His divine image. And it informs us regarding what is right or wrong
as free moral agents. You have free will to sin, but you don't really have a right to sin. Nobody has a right to sin. If you had a right to sin, then God would not send us to hell for sin. So we have free will, but as one of my friends always says, God has the ultimate consequence in his hands. He's not letting that go. I urge you all the more to do this in order that I may be restored to you sooner. I don't understand what that's all about. I did a little research on it, couldn't figure it out. But, you know, Timothy was away from Paul, and Paul was, Timothy got released from the service he was in. He wasn't in prison. So they're trying to make their way to come see these the Hebrew Christians in Jerusalem, I'm imagining. But godly leadership is not lording it over people. Sometimes it's taking it on the chin. As God trains us not to react to the negative. It's not about holding people hostage. It's not about trying to play Pastor God. Touch not thou the Lord's anointed and all that stuff. You know, yesterday at this meeting, someone had a question. They called me Reverend Wallace. I said, I'm not trying to be a jerk here. I don't want to insult people, but please don't call me Reverend. That's not a biblical term. I'm no more revered than anybody else. Ask my wife, who may be too kind to tell it all to you. So, if we're going to do what is honorable, it's doing what is good, advantageous, and appealing to the Lord. It's trying to find the best in all things. Everybody can complain. It's the lowest form of knowledge. I know enough to complain. It doesn't really make you smart. It just, you basically see what an eighth grader can see. So if you want to act honorably, you got to do what is appealing to God. You know, as a godly leader, we're not know-it-alls. I don't think I have all the answers. I was doing a funeral a couple of weeks ago for one of my high school friends whose 35-year-old son had suddenly died. And a couple of years ago, had he called me, I would have said, I can't do that funeral. Well, who am I? But. This is a good but. But my friend needed help. Do I have a magic wand that's going to make their pain go away? No. Did I have a miracle that's going to bring him back to life? No. But those people were looking to the only Christian that they knew to come alongside a hurting family and do for them in that moment what they could not do for themselves because they were too grief-stricken and they had preachers in their family. His sister is the treasurer of a church. Their mother has built 3 churches, kind of a wealthy family, more or less, not single-handedly, but certainly influentially, had built 3 churches. Who am I? I'm a person who could say, God, I'm not going there because of who I am. I'm going to step into that situation looking for you to work. Next slide. Now, what qualifies us? It's Christ's work on the cross. We are positioned in the heavenlies. You know, you have been seated and raised, it tells us in Ephesians. It's all been settled. All the words that talk about our salvation in Scripture are past tense words. You have been saved. You have been redeemed. You have been sanctified. Once again, Christ does not jump down off the cross, dust himself off, and say, "Whoo, I've just done died for you because you blew it." He doesn't do that. Can we love him enough to take him at his word? I mean, all of us have probably had situations in our lives where you got up the next morning and you said, "How or why should I even get out of bed, given what I just did?" But I love God more than I love myself. I love God more than I love my failures. I love God more than I hate my failures. I love God more than I am ashamed of my failures. I love God more than I am afraid of committing those failures again. Now may the God of peace, that word means life-promoting harmony. May the God of peace, who promotes life in your life that is harmonious with his life, it makes us whole. It brought Jesus again from the dead, who is the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant. Equip us, that means it makes us fully trained and prepared. You know, you spend your time doing what God wants you to do, you really would spend less time doing the things that make us ashamed. If you are where God wants you on Saturday night, of course you're going to be in church Sunday morning. But if you fail Saturday night, you may be too ashamed to come to church Sunday morning. Not here. Just look around. We got no stones to throw. Yes, we hold up the Word of God as our standard. And we all want to encourage each other, exhort each other to reach that standard. But we all fall short. We have nothing to hold over you. That word goes on to say, everything good, that means it originates from God. And it is empowered by him in our lives through faith. Are you living by faith today? Preach the sermon to yourself. I have been redeemed. I am a blood-bought person. Christ is here for me. Yet he's not here in the sense that he is going to be a tag. He's not your tag-along boy. As you go off and seek the humanistic horizon of self-fulfillment. God loves us more than we love ourselves. You may counterfeit a bunch of checks thinking you love your life, but God loves you more and he knows that's not a good thing for you to do. You may stick a needle in your arm, but God loves you more. He would not do that to you. You may kind of ruin your conscience through sin. You may have your conscience seared by sin, but God loves us so much, he would never do that to us. And how do we get back? How do we come back from all those circumstances and situations? We start relating to who God is. That which God originates in us, which is good. When I came to Christ, it was like coming home to myself. I always dreamed life could be a certain way. I always dreamed I could be a certain way, but I was such a punk. I was never going to be that way. And I came to Christ, started reading the Bible. And I'm like, wow, I always dreamed life could be this way. And before I did that, I left America and went to Germany, trying to change my life. But I didn't change my life. I just changed my circle. I just changed my location. I did my mess in another location. But God heard me. He heard my cry. I didn't answer that. I didn't answer when he tried to call, when he tried to respond to my cry in America. I didn't listen. But he pursued me across the ocean. All we have to do is yield. So, what does it mean to yield? It means that you are actually going to do his will. It means that you are going to cooperate with his planned agenda. I was in Germany and an older guy told me one day, he goes, "Earl, if you follow Christ, you don't know tomorrow whether or not you're going to be in Africa or India." I said to myself, I'm a very poor person. I know where I'm going to be when I leave here. I'm going home. People like me are not supposed to do the things that I do. And I don't think I have any great life, by the way. But I did pray. I used to say, Lord. And I was working for the state of New York in an office in Schenectady. My children used to always ask me, hey, Dad, when you were a child, was it your ambition to be a balding, slightly overweight guy who worked for the state? They are their mother's children. And I would say, well, my ambition was to have a job. And I would meet these people. They'd have company cars. They were salesmen. I'm like, well, it'd be really cool to have a company car and be a salesman. And I got promoted and became a regional overseer, a senior counselor. And I was traveling from Hudson to Messina. I had a state car. Well, that got kind of old, you know. I mean, after 3 years, you know, driving through the same, you know, 12, 13 offices. I said, God, it would be really cool if I could get a job where I could travel the rest of the state. And when I got those other jobs, I was meeting people from GM and different companies, and I thought, you know, it would be really cool, Lord, if I could, like, you know, go to Malaysia or something and, for work. And because of the things that God had me do, we were very successful. So I wrote a book about how to achieve these things with large numbers of people called The Three-Dimensional Leader, Negotiating Your Mission, Resources, and Context. And a company from Dubai contacted me on LinkedIn. And I started going to Malaysia. I hope, Lord willing, if everything works out, I'll be in Australia for them this summer. I mean, I go to Dubai almost every December. God is fulfilling a dream. Kind of the downside of that is my book is a leadership book about the book of Judges, and I'm kind of going to arid places at times. Don't put the Lord in a box. Let God be God in your life. Don't say but. Say how. If this is really you, Lord, just show me how. It's hard for me to believe that you'd be calling me to this, given who I am. But if it's you, just show me how. Make the connections. Lead me to the right people that can make the connections to do these things. Now, don't get blessed by God and try to run off and seek your own humanistic horizon of self-fulfillment. It is fulfilling. It is fun. But God is bringing you there because he wants you to be his man, his woman in that situation. While you're having fun. Next slide. Did you have planned agenda on two slides?
No.
Okay, because I know I took one out of your notes, but they're both my slides. All right, now, what does it mean in Hebrews 13:21 that you may do his will? It means you're going to cooperate with his planned agenda. You know, God gives you the desires of your heart. I was always praying, Lord, I want my heart to be your heart. I want to think what you think. I want to feel what you feel. And so when I get these desires, okay, God, I would like to travel to a certain place. That's God working in me so that we can cooperate together with his plan. So he works in us that which is pleasing to him, and that means it fully agrees with what God is doing. See? God is not grabbing you by the collar and shaking you every which way but loose. He does do that in a way. But he's conforming us to his image. And you look at all these terms in the Greek. Agreeable. Cooperate. Isn't it kind of cool? It's not some drudgery. It's not some, I'm God and you know what you're like, so you're going to get it. It's not what he's doing with us. It's challenging to be transformed when you're a headstrong, arrogant person. And I bet one out of one of us here can kind of fit that description. So yes, in some ways, God is going to grab you by your collar and shake you every which way but loose. But when you yield, we always say, Lord, oh God, just change me. I want to be more like you. And then when he starts working in our lives, we freak out. It was explained to me once like this. You say, oh God, I want to be a more spiritual person, deal with my flesh. And he says, I'm going to tear your flesh. And you're like, ah, you get that. You go, whoo, that felt so good. Yeah. I walked into the air terminal, and I looked at the car rental line, and I realized I'm not getting a car at this location today. So I turned to a security agent and I said, where can I go get a car? Well, there's a place way over. I said, okay, how do I get there? Later at the conference, I saw people in line. And they said, boy, you're lucky you left that line. I said, I know. But that's where I met the guy who had forged the checks. That was only one guy I met. I sat next to a college basketball player, and he had his little phone, and he was watching an amazing video, and I said, who is that? He goes, that's me. I said, did they ever film a shot that you miss?
Never missed a shot.
Yeah. And he said, I said, where are you going? He goes, I'm on my way back to college. And I don't even know how we got into it. But you know that why so many, this guy says it's not going to happen to me, but you know why so many Christian kids go to college and they come back as a practically, you know, functional atheist? It's because so much of what college teaches them can only be true if the Bible is not. You only know if you're a homosexual if you try it. You know what kind of guilt that's going to cause kids trying that mess? Well, that can only be true if God did not make us male and female. Man-made global warming and sustainability can only be true if Genesis 1, 28 through 31 is not true. God says, eat from all this vegetation and animals, for in it I have placed seed. We don't know how many seeds are in a grape, but we do know that there's a grape arbor in every grape because of the multiplication factor of seeds. If they're so worried about the world falling apart and sustainability, why is our government conspiring with Monsanto to make seedless fruits and vegetables? The kid said, you know, I know that, he says, when I was in fifth grade, I realized that everything they were teaching me was a lie about the Bible.
Wow.
But I didn't know what to do about it until today. So, Jesus Christ has glory forever and ever, and that's renown and splendor. You walk into a place, I was in Malaysia once, I was in Dubai, and it was a big snowstorm here in New York State, so we couldn't go anywhere. Thousands of people in the airport complaining, fighting with people, arguing with the airline people. Like, they can't control the weather. But you know, 2 years ago, I'm an important man. I got to get some. I would have been, 5 years ago, 10 years ago, I would have been doing that. But now I know. If God says you're not going yet, there's a reason. There's somebody in this line that he wants to reach. I'm in the world, but I'm not of the world. Next slide. We're going to wrap up here. Our challenge is to bear up under God's transformation process, which makes us accountable to him. If you're accountable, you're going to bear up. The word bear means you're going to endure and you're going to hold up. Under God's word of exhortation. Do you read the Bible, or is the Bible reading you?
Sometimes I feel like the Bible's reading
me. Yeah, I've had sinners tell me, man, I tried reading that book, and oh man, it convicted me. I had Christians tell me they stopped their growth, they stunt their growth. You know what an exhortation is? It's a call or urging that delivers, that sets you free. It delivers evidence that stands up in God's court. It sets you free so that you can hold up in God's court. Now, he's already, you know, we're already sanctified and justified. You're in heaven. You're going to heaven. The challenge is, are you going to go to heaven with your diapers on? Two-year-old, thumb stuck in your mouth. I want, I want, I want. We used to say in the military, wah, wah, wah. I want my milk and cookies. And by the sound of it, you want them right now. So the Bible says in Romans 14:12, so then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Now that account is going to be like it's in Corinthians, where you know a judgment says we're going to be saved this through fire, and so like you're going to be in heaven, and there's going to be this big strong angel, and they're going to pull this big wagon of works, and you're going, what's that? And goes, those are the works you did on earth for the Lord, or at least you did them in the name of the Lord. You're like, I did all that, and then God's going to set fire to it. They get the little dustpan with the ashes. Come on, now you have to have a better expectation than that, right? Maybe, hey, you know what? I'm just going to be glad to be there. So each of us will give an account of himself to God. Now, this whole book ends with prayer. It says, greet all the leaders and all the saints. Those who come from Italy, where it says in Rome, where Paul was in prison, by the way. A pastor told me this week that he went to the tomb, I don't know if it was the exact cell. They said it was, but it could have been a tourist trap. But he said it was like this, where they held these prisoners. And he goes, I was astounded that Paul wrote the Bible, that God worked in Paul and he wrote the Bible, that he saw God clearly enough, heard God clearly enough in those circumstances to write the Bible. Can you see God in your circumstances? Or do you just see the circumstance? You're never going to get to a better circumstance by focusing on the circumstance. You get the better circumstances by focusing on God. And saying, how? I don't see any way out of here. But Lord, I believe you're calling me out of this. How? Walk me through the how.